Blackstone Audio presents Joseph P. Kennedy Presents His Hollywood Years by Cari Beauchamp. For Tom Flynn. All arrogance will reap a harvest rich in tears. God calls men to a heavy reckoning for overweening pride. Herodotus. Underlined by Robert Kennedy in his copy of Edith Hamilton's The Greek Way. Preface. Mention the name Joseph P. Kennedy, the patriarch of America's royal family, and it evokes a mental picture. An older man smiling out from a photograph surrounded by numerous family members, or perhaps he is gaunt and wheelchair-bound, felled by a stroke. Erase those images. Visualize instead a young man in his mid-30s, a wickedly handsome six-footer, exuding vitality and roguish charm. He strides confidently into a room wearing the most wonderful smile that seemed to light up his entire face, impressing everyone he met with his warm handshake and his friendly volubility. His vibrant energy fuels a head-turning charisma that commands attention. You felt not just that you were the only one in the room that mattered, recalls Joan Fontaine, but the only one in the world. With bright blue eyes behind wire-rimmed glasses, a frequent laugh, and a tendency to slap his thigh when amused, he is strikingly different from the typical Wall Street banker or studio mogul. This is the man who took Hollywood by storm, at one point running four companies simultaneously when no one before or since ran more than one. He was profiled in national magazines and newspapers as a brilliant financial wunderkind, the most intriguing personality in the motion picture world, and the person who now monopolizes conversation in the studios and on location. Kennedy was the blonde Moses, leading film companies into profitable territory as they faced the pivotal years of converting from silent films to sound. In the process, he was instrumental in killing vaudeville. The mystique around him grew so thick that Fortune magazine warned, "The legends are so luxuriant that when you see Joe Kennedy, you are likely to be startled to find him as plain and matter-of-fact as he is. A healthy, hardy, good-natured, sandy-haired Irish family man, athletic, unperplexed, easily pleased, hot-tempered, independent, and restless as they come." Luella Parsons hailed Joe Kennedy as the coming Napoleon of the movies, the White Knight with a wherewithal to save film studios by bringing bankers and corporate representatives onto their boards of directors. He was the architect of the mergers that laid the groundwork for today's Hollywood. While even he might be surprised to find that United Artists, Metro-Goldwyn-Mayer, and Columbia are now all partially owned by the same multinational conglomerate, he was the one who designed that very blueprint. Kennedy was the first financier to simply buy a studio. Fortune used the metaphor of a chess game to describe his Hollywood climb. Taking small pawns, such as Robertson Cole and FBO, and methodically knocking down the knights and bishops of Pathé and Keith Albee Orpheum to create the Queen of RKO in less than 4 years. They concluded that Kennedy moved so fast that opinions still differ as to whether he left a string of reorganized companies or a heap of wreckage behind him. Over 100 films were released under the banner of Joseph P. Kennedy Presents, during which time he influenced the careers and personal lives of Gloria Swanson, Marlena Dietrich, and the cowboy stars Fred Thompson and Tom Mix, as well as dozens of other investors, executives, and underlings. Kennedy was a multifaceted, magnetic charmer, a devious visionary with exquisite timing, and more than a flash of genius. And nothing, including the destruction of other people's careers, deterred his consuming passion to increase his personal bank accounts. "Not a half dozen men have been able to keep the whole equation of pictures in their heads," F. Scott Fitzgerald noted in his final novel, The Last Tycoon. Joe Kennedy was not one of those men. for he had no appreciation of the nuances of storytelling or an ability to spark true creative collaboration. However, to paraphrase Fitzgerald, Kennedy may have been the only one to have the whole economic equation in his head, and that is a key to understanding him. He saw everything and everyone, from Gloria Swanson to Adolf Hitler, through a lens of dollars and cents. When he first arrived in Hollywood in 1926, no one knew Joe Kennedy as the man he would become. He wasn't that man yet. He was already more than well off, always meticulously dressed and chauffeured in his Rolls Royce, but he had yet to accumulate his fortune. His wealth was estimated at a little over $1 million, and he would increase that tenfold over the 5 years he was immersed in the film industry. When Kennedy left Hollywood, he already had so much money that making the rest of it, which must have been many, many millions, was almost a routine affair. He cut the wave at exactly the right moment. And, perhaps more important, the timing of his departure was perfect. By 1932, he was the richest Irish-American in the world, and while he would continue to build capital through other ventures, it was Hollywood that provided the foundation of his wealth. It was also Hollywood where he learned how to perform as a public personality, and where he came to believe that how you were perceived was more important than who you were. The skills and knowledge he gained would affect everything he did and influenced from then on, from how he presented his family to the world to his son's election to the presidency. This is the story of those Hollywood years. Chapter 1. America's Youngest Bank President, 1888 to 1919. The family that Joseph Patrick Kennedy was born into on September 6, 1888, was more comfortable than that of most Boston Irish Catholics. His father, Patrick Joseph, known to everyone as PJ, was a 30-year-old member of the Massachusetts House of Representatives, and his mother, Mary Augusta Hickey Kennedy, was the daughter of a relatively well-to-do family. Although Boston in 1888 was heavily populated by Irish Catholics, it was dominated by the Protestants, who had founded it 250 years before. John Winthrop and John Cotton, along with the Quincys and the Saltonstalls, had arrived with the strict and codified purpose of establishing their city upon a hill. The churches and schools they had built, and their streets and the common ground, remained the city's defining touchstones, and their descendants still ruled Boston society. The Irish population had skyrocketed with the potato famines of the late 1840s, and one of their own was elected mayor in 1885. Yet when openings for work were advertised, "Protestant only" or "Irish need not apply" were all too familiar provisos. P.J. Kennedy's father, Patrick, had immigrated to Boston from Ireland after the second potato famine in 1848. Unlike those fleeing poverty and starvation in coffin ships, Patrick was a younger son of a landed family, and he arrived as a passenger on a scheduled liner. Half of the Boston Irish were tagged as laborers, but Patrick was a skilled artisan, much in demand as a cooper, making the kegs and barrels used for storing and shipping everything from China to produce. He married fellow emigre Bridget Murphy, and they were already the parents of three daughters when PJ was born on January 15, 1858. A few months later, Patrick died at the age of 35, a victim of cholera or consumption, without leaving a will. Bridget put up the $600 bond the court required for her to be named executor of Patrick's estate, and was left with a home large enough to take in a boarder. Though the story is often told of her working at a notions shop on the docks, she may actually have owned the store. The family was far from wealthy, but PJ's older sisters all married well. By the time he had finished his schooling in his late teens, PJ was working on the docks as a stevedore. He soon saved enough to buy his own lager bar.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.